Do you know how many people live in the state of Colorado? It's roughly 6 million people. Now, do you know how many people die every year due to environmental pollution? An estimated 9 million people. This is what we lose every year due to environmental pollution. It's 1.5 Colorado states. Now, scientists, young activists, indigenous peoples have been telling us for decades that this environmental crisis that we are facing needs systemic and transformative changes. And this is where human rights come into play, because history has shown us that human rights, when recognized, can have those transformative changes in society, that they can be used as tools to protect us. So today, I'm here to talk to you about a human right that you might not know about. This is the human right to a clean, healthy, and sustainable environment, recognized by the United Nations General Assembly in 2022. I'll show you how and where this right has recently and potentially been violated across the globe through a quantitative analysis that we've carried out here at CU Boulder. But first, let me introduce you to the rights. Let's get to know what these environmental rights are all about. So the rights focus on our everyday lives. If met, they guarantee our right to breathe clean air, to access clean and safe drinking water, a necessity starkly illustrated by the lead contamination in Denver or in Flint, Michigan, where people need to use filters to drink clean water. It also extends to our right to a safe climate. And a safe climate encapsulates a lot of things, but just to give you an example, think of the escalating heat stress faced by many agricultural workers all over the world. The right also considers our right to clean and healthy food, and also to live, work, and play in non-toxic environments, a right that has been systematically violated in places like La Oroya, Peru, where children are exposed to lead smelting. Now, smelting is a process in which you heat and melt the ore to get the mineral. And in children, when they're exposed to lead smelting specifically, this can have a direct impact on their brain development. I want you to remember this for later on. Finally, the right also extends to our right to clean ecosystems and biodiversity. Now, everyone here in this room might think, you know what? I'm not directly impacted by any of these rights violations. I live in a clean environment, especially if you're coming from Colorado, especially if you're coming from Boulder. Well, let us prove you wrong. CU Professor Zia Merabi and I, we have assessed how likely it is for any individual across the globe to face any of those right violations. In our analysis, we assess 5 out of the 6 UN-recognized violations, the 5 that you see on screen, and we find that over 99% of the global population faces at least one potential right violation, with more than 49% facing at least 3. This is half of the planet facing at least 3 potential right violations out of 5. Let me show that to you in a map. So here I have incorporated 2 things. One is the spike. So the bigger the spike, the greater the number of people living in an area. And 2 is the color scheme that goes from bright yellow for 1 potential right violation in that area to dark red for 5 potential right violations. The interesting thing is that no matter where you focus on, what region of the world, let it be sub-Saharan Africa, Europe and Central Asia, South Asia, these potential right violations have no real escape. They are not isolated events, so they shouldn't be treated as one. Our research also reveals a disturbing pattern, and this is that these potential right violations are not equally distributed across the globe. So for example, imagine that we're looking at two countries, country A and country B, from far away. Country A has a greenish color, meaning that the average exposure is mild to these right violations, and country B has a worse average exposure. What we find in our results is that when we zoom into those countries, the country that had a greater average exposure also shows greater inequality within it. So in other words, if the average exposure in a country increases, the people living in that country will be more unequal in terms of exposure as well. One topic that we haven't been able to address due to lack of global disaggregated data is how these environmental challenges impact differently depending on gender. But we know that that's the case, thanks to more local and regional studies coming mainly from well-known institutions and organizations like the United Nations FAO or the WHO. And for instance, millions of women suffer premature deaths due to indoor household pollution, air pollution, coming mainly from gendered cooking responsibilities. And in many regions, it's normally women and girls who are assigned the task of water collection, a task that has been intensified due to water scarcity, leading to an increase on health burden. So I've shown you the results of our analysis. Our analysis goes longer, but for the sake of this talk, I've decided to choose the most important outcomes. Now that we have the data in our hands, the question is, what now? Well, let's try to put our awareness into action. Individual actions like recycling, taking public transportation, or installing a solar panel on the roof of your house. Those actions are all necessary and are admirable, but they're also a drop in the ocean of change that is required. And deep down, we know that. Politicians know that. CEOs of the biggest companies that pollute the most know that as well. The essence of the issue is not found on individual actions. It is found on the power and policy systems that govern our reality, because issues like Denver's lead contaminated water or Boulder's high levels of ozone during summer because of fracking and traffic, those are not mere environmental concerns. Those are infringements upon our rights, upon our children's rights. So as I said, individual actions are necessary. But today, I'd like to encourage you to take a step forward together towards collective action. And I'll show you two examples of success where collective action has worked to protect our rights. Do you remember how I told you that children in La Oroya were exposed to harmful lead smelting? Let's put some context to that example. So La Oroya is a city 176 kilometers from Lima, the capital of Peru. Now the city was built and grew around a metallurgical complex that was established as early as in the 1920s. And the economic activity that deteriorated the air quality of La Oroya was precisely the processing of minerals, especially smelting of heavy metals like lead. Now, the ownership of the complex shifted throughout the years, but the most critical issue remains that the state knowingly allowed the metallurgical complex to pollute throughout the years. The people from La Oroya have been fighting for the right to a healthy environment to be recognized for over two decades now. And thanks to their tireless fight and support coming from many organizations, they were able to take the case in front of the Inter-American Commission of Human Rights. The commission decided in 2021, made strong recommendations that are, and this is very important, unenforceable. So the commission forwarded the case to the Court of Human Rights because of two reasons. One, because of the importance of the issue, and two, because the court can issue legally binding orders against a state. The court is supposed to be ruling soon, expected March 2024. So I want you to listen closely and realize that any decision that will be made was not a result of an individual action. It was collective effort. The second example is a little bit more personal. I come from the Basque Country. My hometown is close to this beautiful biosphere called Urdaibai. It's a beautiful place. It's actually made up by several rich ecosystems. But not long ago, we heard that the government was planning on building an extension of the Guggenheim Art Museum on the biosphere. Now, the Guggenheim Museum already exists in the closest city called Bilbao, but the government was planning on building an extension of it on the biosphere. A biosphere that was already in danger because it was not well taken care of throughout the years. So instead of just cleaning it and reviving it and preserving it for future local generations, the idea was to sacrifice it for the sake of tourism. As of now, the project has stopped at least for another 2 years. And this was not a result of an individual action. There were people organizing demonstrations, people participating in them, people writing articles, joining debates to raise awareness, actively engaging and trying to understand why that biosphere is so valuable to us and why turning it into a museum was not in our interest. In the image on your right-hand side, you can read in Basque language, Urdaibai ez dago salgai, which means Urdaibai is not for sale. And it's a really strong message, right? It goes beyond that. It means that us, the locals, we are not for sale. That nature is not for sale. What is common to these two examples of success? It's collective action. What if someone here today in this auditorium stood up and went to the town hall of Boulder asking for better equality during summer? Would someone listen to this person? Maybe yes, and probably not. Now, think of all of us standing up and going to the town hall, standing up and writing a letter and signing it so that our right to a clean air is respected. We are constantly interconnected to people, and if we rely on that interconnectedness, we can at least try to face the environmental crisis, which is a structural problem. We cannot rely on individual actions to try to solve a structural problem. Today, I'd like you to leave with an image that became famous during the Renaissance. This is one of the most famous paintings by Botticelli, La Primavera. It's an allegorical representation of spring. And in the center of the painting, we have Venus. But I want you to focus on the three women that are with her. These are the three graces. They come from Greek mythology. And I think they are a great representation of this interconnectedness that I was talking about. They've been represented and have endured in our history throughout the years. You can see them here in sculptures. You can see them in a photograph taken in 1979 in Bronx. You can see them in a painting, 2011. They have endured in our history, inspiring artists until today. Now, no matter which of the interpretations of the three graces you decide is true, the reality is that the three women dance with intertwined hands. A general view is that one of them stands for giving a gift, one of them for receiving it, and one of them for returning it, closing that circle. In the face of today's environmental crisis, the message of the three graces is more relevant than ever. This image, as simple as it might seem, is a political act. Our collective action is a political act through which we can shape our reality, our economy, and thus our society. So I'd like to encourage you all to use it, to use that collective action to face the environmental issues and to demand those changes. Thank you.